Hi, this is Kay. Thank you for checking out today's podcast of Hanging with the Hayters. We want to give special thanks to our sponsor, Sunny Horn, with Leaders Financial Group. You can give them a call at 832-381-2515.
You are listening to Lone Star Community Radio on 104.5 KCZW LP Conroe and 106.1 KZCC LP Conroe. And worldwide at IRLoneStar.com.
And welcome to this week's Hanging with the Hayters with the husband and wife duo, Mark and Kay here.
That's me and you. Oh, man. And folks, we're sorry. We're, it went over. They had to play another song. And it's because of the mailman. Downtown Conroe, ladies and gentlemen, there was one vacant parking place, and we come around the bend, and the mailman's right in front of us, and he pulls right in there.
To the only parking place on this block.
So I had to hop out, and Kay had to drive around.
I made the corner.
It was. By the way, it is such a beautiful day, isn't it, Kay?
It is, and there's a breeze blowing. We had our windows open for a while this morning. It was so nice.
I woke up and opened the windows, and almost it was 60 degrees, and it felt so good until, of course, the leaf blower guy and the lawnmower person started down the street. It was
The middle of the week. It's okay. Yeah. It's okay.
By the way, speaking of today, and that's what we're talking about, ladies and gentlemen, it's April the 5th. And it happens to be on April 6th, that would be tomorrow, is the 100th anniversary of the time the United States got involved in World War I. The war started in 1914, but we didn't get in it until April 6th of 1917.
And what precipitated us deciding we had to get in?
Okay, there were several things. We were going to stay out of the war. Woodrow Wilson got elected for saying, I've kept you out of war. This was in 1916 he got elected, and he did. But son of a gun, how many of you remember, raise your hand, about the Lusitania getting sunk? It was a British ocean liner headed for the United States that was had about a couple thousand or a thousand or so.
Passengers?
American passengers.
American passengers.
And the Germans sunk it. And come to find out, history tells us later that the Lusitania was laden with explosives below deck. And I don't, they were coming to the United States. I don't understand that. Maybe they were coming from the United States to Britain.
Maybe.
I'm confusing the daylight.
But the Germans sunk it because they knew there were munitions on
board?
They
knew something. They wouldn't have sunk an ocean liner. By the way, and another reason was the fact that the Zimmerman note, son of a gun, an ambassador from Germany sent a message that was intercepted. It was a code intercepted by the Brits, and they hung on to it for a while. But what it was a promise to Mexico that if they declared war on the United States, that when the war was over, Mexico would get Texas. Isn't that something? And whenever
sneaky.
Britain waited till the last minute to release it because they wanted the United States to go ape crud at that point, and we did. And by the way, one reason we went ape crud is because the Germans started sinking our merchant ships going to Britain, and you know we were going to supply
Britain. They didn't
want
them to get supplies.
And they
finally
said, "Okay, U.S., you might as well get in because we're going to blow the daylights out of your ships." And they did, and we got into war. By the way, in today's Courier, Kay, I wanted to mention this once again. I plugged the daylights out of this because it's fascinating as all get out to me. It is the Courier's part where they're talking about Montgomery County.
Their history section.
It's the history, Kay, and I like history. And here is the opening shot here. They've got the front page of the Courier, and this is from April the 12th, actually. But what it's doing is it's announcing that the war is on and who, what Montgomery County people or Conroe people are going into the war. And there is a poster they have in the middle of this that is... You know, the country's kind of crazy now, one way or the other, you know, regarding, you know, foreign policy and all. Mm-hmm. And I want you to listen to this, Kay. Here is a poster, and it was a notice that was put up by the sheriff, M.A. Anderson, from Montgomery County. And it says, notice to the public, no loafing in Montgomery County. Under direction of the United States authorities, all police officers are being called upon to take action looking to the elimination of all idleness and loafing of all able-bodied persons in every town and community. In furtherance of this suggestion, the slogan of Montgomery County shall be, go to war, go to work, or go to jail. Very respectfully, Anderson, M.A. Anderson, Sheriff, there was very little tolerance
that
for...
That was serious time.
Yeah.
Serious time. So and that wasn't in World War II.
Oh, yeah.
As well. I mean, it was total war effort.
Yeah.
And it needed to be.
Now, it was best not to be homeless back then. They would put you in war. Kay, speaking of being homeless, did your mom ever talk about the poor farms? Or did they have them in...
Yes. My parents, both of them, grew up on farms. My dad from Delta County, the Cooper area, and mother in the Greenville area. And, of course, most everybody that they knew at that point that was farmers, I mean, they could eat and stuff, but they certainly weren't putting money in the bank. If they came out ahead by a few bucks at the end of the year, it was a good thing.
Right.
But it's interesting, mother knew the Audie Murphy family.
Yes. And... she picked cotton with Audie Murphy.
Yes, she did, and she said she said if you thought people were poor, you thought of the Murphy family.
Yeah.
And she said he learned how to shoot so well because he was supplying the meat for the family.
Right. Kate, what I was referring to is back then, if you were homeless, particularly in Oklahoma, Bristol, Oklahoma, where my mom was from, they had a poor farm, and that's for homeless people, and there were a lot of farmers that didn't have anything.
Oh, no, I never heard about that.
They sent them to a little... acreage where they had built, shacks for them to live in and a place for them to farm, and it's called the poor farm. Poor farm, and the parents used to tell. In fact, the parents used to tell Elsie and, "Hey, if you don't behave, we're going to the poor farm." You know, and that's a terrible thing to say, but that's something they had. Folks,
that was Depression era when our parents were growing up, and I know Mom said they had a big garden and they grew chickens and hogs and all that.
Yeah,
and Granddad was really good about, taking food to families that were in need.
There was a lot of that back then.
Yeah.
By the way, I wanted to mention a shout out to Sonny Horn, ladies and gentlemen, our sponsor with Leaders Financial Group. Sonny, howdy. I hope all is going well on this beautiful day for you. And also, we're having a special guest, and I'm going to tell you a little bit more about him later, but it is a gentleman by the name of Charles Parker. He is with Mod Pizza and
MOD Pizza.
MOD. So it must be an acronym. It's capital MOD.
We'll ask.
We'll ask about that. But there is just something about this place that I first saw it on national news, Mod Pizza, and their the way they operate and they seem to have a good sense for community, for charities and all, but they make a super pizza that I really like, so I just wanted to have them on the air today. So Charles Carter has agreed to show up. Anyway, we're going to have him during our third break around 12:30. Right now, Kay, we need to mention about the pet parade because we were there last night, and it was so fascinating.
It was a big crowd.
Yeah.
It was like the biggest crowd I remember.
Yeah, and it was indoors, and they had three fans blowing on me, but I still sweated like a bad dog.
Well, it was an open pavilion.
Yeah.
So we had a roof over our heads.
Oh, man. And anyway, we had a bunch of entries. This was for children 8 years and younger, and they each had to have a pet. And, Kay, I don't think I've been there maybe seven times. Al and I were there, and you were have been there every time. There was apparently the largest group of kids that could not communicate, could not tell me anything. If you're standing on a stage, ladies and gentlemen, mic'd up, and you're asking a kid, the name of your pet, and one girl just wanted to eat the microphone, She was young, but I thought she could talk. She just put her mouth, and one took the microphone from me and put their mouth on it, and I felt like a really lousy interviewer. You know how you're not supposed to ask a question that's just yes or no, but they wouldn't even say yes or no. So
a lot of them were really young.
Yeah.
And you get up in front of a crowd and it's
oh, they were young.
Yeah. And one of them hadn't learned how to talk yet, so there wasn't.
That's true.
Wasn't a whole
dressed
lot.
Dressed up like a pink poodle,
and that
was
the pet.
That was the pet.
Was their little miniature pink poodle.
Kay, I mentioned to the sponsors of the pet parade that we would announce the winners. Would you share that information?
Absolutely.
With
there were
underneath
there,
that.
There were three categories. They had a small dog category, and there were six entries. Second place went to Lacasey Driscoll and her little dog Coco. Mm-hmm. First place went to a little girl by the name of Andy Fail, and her little dog Rosie was a cute little kind of a terrier-looking dog, kind of a mix.
Though. I'm glad you remember
that. She called it a mutt.
I did not write the types of animals that were down there, so I forgot what a lot of them are. But with respect to small dogs and all, they were just cute as they could be. And in many cases, even the children who showed them that didn't talk were dressed up so cute.
They did. They wore costumes.
Okay, large dog came.
In the large breed, the second place winner went to Remy, who was probably one. Well, he was a very cool pit bull.
Oh, man, that
Caesar
dog
Milan would
had
have been
the biggest
so
mouth. And they did not call it a pit bull. It was some box or something mixed. I don't know what it was.
Well, he probably
like
may not
bull.
Have been
yeah.
full blood, but it was a pit.
You can't see me, ladies and gentlemen, but I'm putting my hands out to the size of this dog's mouth.
It went from ear to ear.
And it was short and squatty. And what was so neat, you see a dog that's that vicious looking and... it was just so sweet.
I watched him the whole time, and he just was there. He'd lay down. He'd look around.
Okay, hit us with the miscellaneous, and then we've got to go to a break. Go ahead.
Okay. For other, second place went to Greenlee Wallace for her pet Frisbee, and I think that was the three-legged cat. We kind of get confused at the end.
Yeah, we had one cat, and it was three-legged, and I don't like cats. Much at all, but this was a nice cat, the nicest three-legged cat I've ever seen.
Very calm,
yeah.
Very calm. And first place went to Kelsey Perry, and she brought her calf.
Was that a girl?
Leo.
Kelsey? It looked like a guy. He was dressed like an Indian.
It may have been a little boy. You know these names these days.
The
you can't tell.
Okay, the names were great. Give me some of those first names of those kids over here. Listen to these names. Of course, there's Briley. Anyway, it's spelled Briley. Karis. Riley. Greenlee. Haley, spelled really weird. And Tinsley. Lucchese. Gentry. A young lady named Gentry. I think it's a young lady in Aubrey. Anyway, super names, super kids. Just,
anyway, it was a fun night.
I think they were intimidated by me. And Big Al was there. I couldn't have made it without Big Al. He was doing really good. And right now, ladies and gentlemen, we can't make it without taking this short break. And we'll be back with more Hanging with the Hayters in just a couple of minutes.
Break time, people. Restrooms are in the foyer. Back in a couple of minutes with more Hanging with the Hayters.
Hanging with the Hayters is always looking for guests. If you have a project or business that benefits the community, contact us about being on the show at hwthaters@gmail.com. We broadcast live on Wednesdays at noon, and all our shows are archived on YouTube, SoundCloud, and on Suddenlink's Channel 12.
Hello, I'm Sonny Horn with Leaders Financial Group. For 25 years, Leaders has developed a working relationship with each of our clients that aid us in providing them opportunities to retire sooner than they likely thought possible. Our success is attributed largely to our thoroughness in drawing up a workable financial plan for each client. Saving money is tough for most, so we all need to receive the best long-term results possible for our efforts. Leaders Financial Group has earned a reputation for providing greater peace of mind for those who too often feel they're hoping against hope in what seems to be a most complicated financial market. Our goal at Leaders is to provide a keen sense of hope and financial security for those who come to us seeking direction. Process is simple. Phone call even more so. I'm Sonny Horn. Give me a call at 832-381-2515, and we'll help you establish a financial future that'll be ready when you're ready to retire.
And I'm Mark Hayter. One of the clients at Sonny Horn has helped retire sooner than I thought possible. It's our trust in him that led Kay and I to choose Leaders Financial Group as our sponsor.
And the winning ticket number is 47218. Now, back to Hanging with the Hayters on IRLoneStar.com. Yeah.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. Hanging with the Hayters. This is segment two, and Kay, I wanted to would share with the listeners something that interested the daylights out of me. It was in response to an article I wrote actually it'll come out in today's Villager, but it came out in the Trends in the Courier. And in that article, I mentioned something that a pet peeve that always ticks me off, and Kay doesn't agree with it or anything. And so I put down there the comment to the readers. I said, so do you see why I need you? You know, it's a sounding board. And this lady wrote back, and I just love her to pieces, even though I don't know her, Susan Reese. And Susan, if I do know you, I apologize. So many people, when they, you know, act like I know them when I don't. But what I do know is I really like what you wrote. Let me read this to you. She wrote an email. I got permission to do that. She said this: my 10-year-old granddaughter tries to help me with an ongoing quiz on the new language, which is just initials. For example, today I received a reply text, IKR.
That was it?
That was it. IKR. You know, somebody's texting and here's, oh, yeah. IKR. And she said, I figured that one out, and I would have never. And by the way, Charles, I haven't introduced him yet. He said, Charles, would you just nod if you know what IKR stands for? No idea. Thing. It says, I know, right? You know, you're sending information to somebody, IKR. Oh, I know, right? Sheesh, I wouldn't have guessed that. It has no punctuation or anything. So anyway, she said, I can expect this new shortened way of communicating in text messages, but it's showing up in print. This morning, I was checking out the Easter celebration supplement from the Courier. The first church ad that caught my attention was on the bottom of page K2. Here it is. MDPC Concert Series. MDPC Concert Series. And she says, what kind of church could this be? I thought, you know, perhaps it was connected with the police office, you know. Maybe Montgomery County deputy. Anyway. And no address or anything. Anyway, she looked it up and found out that it's Memorial Drive Presbyterian Church. And the newspaper, or they put in this here, and you're supposed to pick it up. Oh, that must be a Memorial Drive in Houston here in Conroe. I'm reading this still, and it's Memorial Drive in Houston Presbyterian Church. Anyway, it's a killer. And she says, I have seen many headlines using acronyms recently, and it is annoying as I don't know what they stand for. I realize I should know more of them, like TOMA, T-O-M-A. It's been in the news a lot, ladies and gentlemen. It stands for Texas.
Office?
No. Texas, it's Open Meetings Act. It's
right,
where if you're
right.
A city councilman, you can't call a councilman over to your house and start making decisions and all. That's just not said. You need to have the public in and stuff like that. Anyway, she said, I know the ACLU, the NAACP, the LGBT, and others for around the years, but now I see my real annoyance is that I turned 70 in March, and these new acronyms are coming fast and furious, and I have a fear that I will lose my ability to keep to communicate and comprehend. Thanks for helping me get my real annoyance out. And that is, Kay, I think that's my lot in life. I think that's what I need to do. And boy, do I, if you've ever talked to anyone from the military, and I've got two nephews who have, they've had tough places they've been. But they can't talk to you without throwing out these things that you, I got my MCGP, and we went to the JRC, and we fired some 814s, and I just want to slap them and say, hey, look, you're talking to a civilian
here,
and I don't know what you're saying. Anyway, fascinating stuff. Susan, thank you so much for informing us about that. I wanted to mention one other thing because I'm not going to have much time. I keep trying to, my watch is 1222. I saw last night, it has nothing to do with anything that we were talking about.
This
today.
Is a new subject?
This is a new subject.
Okay.
It's a turnaround. I watched this documentary, and it was called Magnus, and it had a picture of this boy, and I said, you know, he looked, I don't know, he looked a little strange, high-brow, big cheeks, and I said, I don't know what this is about. I watched it, and son of a gun, this is a chess player. His dad found out how smart he was way back when, and at 13 years old, he becomes a grandmaster, and at 6 years old, he's,
he's beaten
and I don't know what
people,
a grandmaster is. But When they started showing this guy's brain, and what they did is just put diagrams down when he looks at a chessboard, and they started putting lines all over. And this boy could look at things and come up with possibilities, and there's billions of them, but he could just see from that what, you know, the best way to do. And he could know 100 moves ahead and 100 moves.
Wow.
Okay, he did this at once. You know, they can tell you all kinds of things, and they can show you winning, but they blindfolded him and set him in front of a long table that had 10 chess players. And I don't know if they were each grandmasters, but they were good. They blindfolded him so he couldn't see the boards at all. And what they would tell him is one at a time when the person made a move, they would say, you know, pawn to rook two, and he would register that. Okay, number two, and the guy, and he would tell him, okay, it is bishop to whatever. And he would put that in, and as soon as he heard a, you know, the table number and all, he would say what his move is, you know, knight to, you know, king three or whatever. And he did that. They just kept saying, in other words, he had 10 games in his brain with nothing more than an image of each board in his mind. And one after the other, he would play, and then he would say, mate, on three. And then he'd say, okay, queen to knight three, mate, and just beat all 10 of them. That is in the guy's brain. I would like to tell you how it ended, but I will tell you this. He is the number one chess player in the world today. They had him on 60 Minutes. I
missed
that.
He's grown now,
Magnus Carlsen. He is 26 years old now. Norwegian. I think it's the only Norwegian. And I've got a list here because, Kay, it's eerie fascinating of the greatest chess players. And the one who is rated the highest with respect to whenever they voted him in, whenever he won, is Magnus Carlsen. The number one chess player in the world, they say, ever was. No, yeah, right now he is.
Okay.
The best ever was a one-year peak of Bobby Fischer. They said that year before he went, well, I think he was a little nuts anyway, but before he stepped off the deep end, they said the guy was great. But I did want to mention this. He played this a guy who was a top chess player at that time, a guy from India, Anand something or other. And this guy, the way he trained is he looked at computer. Every computer move you could make, and he took all of Magnus Carlsen's moves of every game he had ever recorded in competition. He had it down. He knew what the guy was going to do, and you play 12 games, and when they showed up, Magnus got beat in the first deal, and it really, the boy didn't suffer it very well. I mean, he was upset, and he said, it's over. He tied the next two, and he was just torn, and people kept saying, okay, he's going to lose after so-and-so. He came back after one day of just taking it easy and beat this son of a gun soundly. In 10 games, he beat him. And it was one of these things I assumed that this guy knows what I'm doing. I'm going to do something
I've never
really
done before.
Weird. And he started doing things, and the guy is sitting there. And what was so cool is this Indian guy I like him in everything, but he was so cocky at the beginning, you know, and drinking tea and he'd get up and walk around and while Magnus was over there. And son of a gun, to see this guy sweating at the end, he was just, I like underdogs, but in this case, people say this, they don't know how, obviously, he does it. I think we'll both agree, and I think all of our listeners will agree, this guy was born with something that was really super. But beyond that, his life seemed horrible because he thought of chess day and night.
24/7.
He would be talking to someone, Kay, like I'm talking to you now, and all of a sudden he'd just glaze over and be thinking about a chess game he should have done something to.
Yeah.
Very humble boy, though. He said, the guy was asking him, you know, how are you so good? And he said, I make mistakes in every game. He said, I'm always making mistakes, but I'm, you know, been able to get out of them. And that's, I like to see when somebody actually says that, hey, I'm good. But anyway, great deal, okay? Other stuff coming out. Kay, I did want to mention, if we can go back to the fair, I saw on the Courier today that the Grand Champion Steer Blackout, which was a black, it looked like an Angus to me, but they said it's a rare breed of something or other, so I don't know what it was.
Well, we don't know anything about that.
Congratulations. He is from Splendora K.
That's terrific. That is a lot of work that went into to getting that.
By the way, I had a review I wanted to share also before we go in. You know, in the Courier, there's reviews that are just, you don't see bad reviews in the Courier very often. But and you're not going to see one now because I don't think I brought the right paper. Are y'all still here? Hey, this is so.
You can do it without it.
This guy, and he's very well known in the area, in the county. His name is David Dow Bentley III. By the way, Dick Shishler is a fourth. This guy over here, the president and all of Dick Shishler IV. I've never known a fourth. I've known an eighth because his name was Henry, and everybody knows him. But besides that, here is David Dow Bentley. He's done Crichton Theater things all over, and he is he reviewed me a couple of times, and he was sweeter than sweet because I know it didn't go that well. But here is what he said about Greater Tuna that was at last Friday at the Crichton Theater. Yeah. Greater Tuna was on, and it was obviously not Sears and what's his name?
Right, and it was a touring group, I think. It was not a local production.
But here's what he said. The title is Greater Tuna Rendition Takes a Tumble at Crichton. He says, the characters they portrayed here became more like cartoons than the hilarious and endearing, believable town folk of the original production. Gifted comic timing and the art of pantomime are among the most difficult dramatic arts to master, and both were sadly lacking. The addition of a third cast member, which I think is blasphemous to do that with Greater Tuna, the addition of a third cast member in this version seemed to further diminish the very unique original concept. He said, my greatest happiness was glancing around the theater from time to time to note the numbed expressions of fellow laugh-free audience members who looked as though they had OD'd on dental Novocaine. This is, I like it because it is an honest approach. That's what he said. He did say there were people that laughed out loud. They may have never seen him with the original guys because they were
tremendous.
David Dow, that was, I thought, very good. Right now, what we've got to do is we've got to take a break. We're going to come back with none other than Charles Parker with Mod Pizza. Back in a couple.
Break time, people. Restrooms are in the foyer. Back in a couple of minutes with more Hanging with the Haters.
Hello. I'm Sonny Horn with Leaders Financial Group. For 25 years, Leaders has developed a working relationship with each of our clients that aid us in providing them opportunities to retire sooner than they likely thought possible. Our success is attributed largely to our thoroughness in drawing up a workable financial plan for each client. Saving money is tough for most, so we all need to receive the best long-term results possible for our efforts. Leaders Financial Group has earned a reputation for providing greater peace of mind for those who too often feel they're hoping against hope in what seems to be a most complicated financial market. Our goal at Leaders is to provide a keen sense of hope and financial security for those who come to us seeking direction. Process is simple. Phone call even more so. I'm Sonny Horn. Give me a call at 832-381-2515 and we'll help you establish a financial future that'll be ready when you're ready to retire.
And I'm Mark Hayter. One of the clients at Sonny Horn has helped retire sooner than I thought possible. It's our trust in him that led Kay and I to choose Leaders Financial Group as our sponsor. We hope you'll tune in to our live broadcast every Wednesday at noon on IRLoneStar.com and Conroe's FM 104.5 and 106.1. If you miss one, check out Hanging with the Haters on YouTube or SoundCloud.
You're listening to Hanging with the Haters with Mark and Kay on IRLoneStar.com. Punk.
And we thank all of you listeners for hanging with the haters today. We are back for our second half of the show with Charles Parker. He's coming to us from Mod Pizza.
Charles, thank you so much for being. We're glad to have you. And I am going to let you talk, but just a second, let me mention this to you. Kay and I, what we like to do is if we see something in town that is we consider to be exceptional, I like to bring it to people's attention. And I need to mention right now, this being a community radio, we're not getting a cent from Mod Pizza.
Right.
Whenever I first saw I don't know, it wasn't on 60 Minutes, but was a news segment, a national news segment, and I was very impressed. Number one, I couldn't believe it all because the staff was so upbeat in everything, and there was mention of charity, and each store had a charity of some kind, and the thing is, I watched it, and finally we got one, Charles, here in Conroe. Kay and I went there, and son of a gun.
Yeah.
Food was great, but I don't know how the employee can maintain the enthusiasm they had. But
it's just a whole lot of stuff going on.
Really?
Yeah.
And you're the general manager of the Woodlands.
Yes, sir. I actually opened up Conroe as well back in June.
Son of gun, I didn't know that.
Yeah. You know, we didn't check it out for a long time. I don't know why. It's just that we go, we need to go to Mod Pizza, and we never did. And then I talked to a friend of mine on the phone, and she said, if you and Mark haven't been to Mod Pizza, y'all need to go. That motivated us.
And one thing that interested me in having you here also was the fact that one thing, I've seen it on TV and all, but do I know what to do? I'm scared. Like, I'd never go to the movie theater where they serve pizza and all because I'm scared. I don't know what I'm supposed to do. It's easy as pie.
Instruct the squad members, basically, whenever they come through, and people haven't had, you know, or been to the concept. We try to walk everybody through it, make it as easy as possible. Usually when, you know, you get a first-timer coming in like that, there's so many options. It's like a deer in the headlights. They just freeze.
Yeah.
You know, so our person at the point is usually a person who's very outgoing, very personable, easy to look at, you know, person that's always looking you in the eye as well.
Right.
They kind of just walk you through the system and just make it easier on you. And once you go through once, it's all over. You can just mod is what you make.
Really?
It.
Really?
Yeah, it really is.
Now, I was reading on Facebook and all something about the fact that it's kind of an in-family thing that if you're a cook, you can be the general manager or whatever.
Absolutely.
Did you start?
I started as a general manager. I've managed a lot of different places, but being a cook is probably my favorite part of it. I like standing in front of the oven. I love cooking pizza. It's just fun.
Let me ask you this. How long do those things cook?
It takes about 3.5 minutes.
That's 800-degree oven. And it is just...
That's what's so good about it. You go through the line. You tell them what you want on your pizza. You pick out the size of pizza you want. I think there's two sizes.
We have three sizes. We have
the
medium, which is a 6-inch. And then we have the mod, which is our traditional. It's an 11-inch. That's what we push people more towards. And then we have a mega. It's not any bigger than the mod. It's just 2 11-inch crusts because all of our pizza is, you know, artisan-style thin crust, personal style.
Right.
I try to sell that to, you know, the 2-a-day football players and whatnot.
Right.
You know, the hungry kids, the growing boys, the hosses.
Yeah.
Right. You know, Kay and I get the, mostly I do. Sometimes she'll just get the pizza, but I get the pizza and the salad special. For the price, you cannot, the first time I didn't finish my pizza, and it was a mini pizza, but it looked big in that salad. Folks, you put anything on the salad
that's
on the pizza. I don't care how much stuff you tell that person to put on the pizza, the salad costs the same. Oh, I'd like some, some more hamburger meat.
Put some more cheese on
cheese on it. We have no problem. You want us to go back 6 different times, just let us know. Yeah, everybody should have a smiling face.
That is, I've seen CC Pizza before, and my thought was, I never liked the pizza that much, but I always thought, like, how on earth the mafia's got to own this, because I don't see how they could possibly make a profit off of this.
That was a joke.
It was a joke, CC. The thing is, this is, I really like it, and people have different tastes in pizza, but this was exceptionally well done. How much training do these kids go through?
When you join, we usually start training about, you know, to get out of a junior squad member is about a 30-day ordeal. We start you out as junior, and after that we'll put you in a squad member. I tend to make everybody, you know, do every position at least once or twice. Everybody does everything. So if
you've got a short somewhere, then people know what to
do. Exactly.
Then
someone else can
around.
Just fall into place and then just get in there and
That's
knock
good.
It out.
Cross training. You know?
And there's something else about the, not the clientele, that's me, but the people working there. It's like, you know, at other places, can I have some more? I feel like I'm begging or something, you know. Would you like more cheese on that, or would you like this? What do you want? And it's like, And let me tell you this. It's just an anecdote, but I went in there, and it was the first time, Charles, and I had the salad going here and the pizza, and the girl was asking me what I wanted on the pizza, and I was looking at the salad, and I said, I would like some corn, and she put corn on the pizza and all, and then I figured out what I was doing.
Didn't know you like corn on pizza, did you?
I did not have any idea. And it's not excellent. Just corn, it's grilled corn or something.
It roasted.
Yeah, he asks for corn on his pizza now.
I do it every time, too, as well. Never in the world would I ever thought corn would have been good topping.
Anyway, and salads are great.
A happy
and everything.
Accident.
You mentioned before, did you, you've been a general manager, you opened the Conroe deal. How widespread is it around here? I didn't even know there was one in the
Woodlands. We have, I believe, 16 locations here in the greater Houston area. We've got about four or five more coming by the beginning of the year. Right now, we're at about 214 stores nationwide. We have 6 stores in the UK right now. We just had some partners sign on to develop Florida, Alabama, and Georgia. We look to have around 300 stores at the end of this year.
You know, there's a time when you could overextend yourself, Charles. And do you? Could you tell us a little bit about the person that started this? Understood his stand his name. He was from
Scott and Allie Svensson, are our CEOs. Yeah. Yes,
right. And they were involved, or they started Seattle Coffee.
Yeah. So Scott is he's a graduate out of Harvard Business School. He's a very, very smart man. I am completely confident in having him as a CEO. I just. All I got to do is go in and just go make pizza for a day and let him handle the big stuff. They started a little place called Seattle Coffee Company in, I believe it was 1998 or 95, I believe. They were in London, and his wife started a little coffee company called Seattle's Coffee Company. And then I think in 1998, Starbucks used them as a stepping stone to break into the European market, and they bought all 65 units of their coffee company. And then they made Scott the CEO of all of the operations in Europe at that point, or not CEO, but I'm sorry, president of operations and CEO.
Charles, did they buy just the European Seattle?
Yes, sir.
They buy Seattle's.
They bought Seattle's best coffee company was what it was, and they just bought all 65 units, and then Scott started working for the operations part in Europe after that, and then I think that they started a Italian, Carluccio's is a place that they started after that in 1995, I believe, and and then I think they sold out of it about 2005, and that's when they came back home and started Mod in about 2008, whenever the financial crash and everything was happening. Yeah. They just wanted to create something that was easy, affordable, something a little different.
Yeah.
And it
seemed like he got $87 million or something for the Seattle Coffee, so he had an investment.
I read 20. It was 20. Yeah,
20, that's a lot less than 87. Yeah. I think I was reading about something I saw today, the Pink Diamond.
That was expensive
diamond.
That went for
$72 million. I saw it the other day. Yeah.
It had very little to do with coffee, or in this case, Mod Pizza. I'm assuming you interview. You're the one who interviews.
Yes, sir.
What is it you're looking
for? Yeah, what are you looking for?
I look for personality. Anybody can make a pizza. I don't care about if a person's got tattoos. I don't care where the person's been. I care where they're going. How good are you making the person next to you? Things that just real go-getter attitudes. I mean, a lot of times, when we hire people that, look a little different, turns out they've been, turned down multiple times at other places because of their appearance. Right. But these are some of the hardest workers out there. And, as long as you can keep eye contact, talk to people, that's what we look for. I mean, the pizza sells itself. What I like to sell is that awesome experience that goes along with it.
Yeah.
Quick, fast, personable, small talk, stuff like that.
Yeah. That's one thing that you cannot help picking up on, and I'm talking about Conroe. I haven't been to any others. I'm sure the Woodlands is super. They're all, but when you go in, you see the camaraderie. Not only were they friendly to
we're a team.
Us, they it was a team. Like
right.
Joking around about stuff.
Mm-hmm.
If you're a very professional, stiff-necked son of a gun, you may not like to see. You may want. Oh, I need more respect. These people were so genuine. And just, made the whole pizza experience.
That's what we look for. When you're doing the interview process, you want to look for that, camaraderie, or you get that good feeling back and forth where, the ball's going to each court back and forth like a tennis game.
Could you tell us, and this is out of the blue, you tell us, starting out, what you pay?
We start everybody out at about $10.50. We like to pay more, but we also like to get the better help as
of
well.
Course.
I don't want to, train people just to stand around. So that all falls into... When we do get going, people working 2 or 3 positions or, working with each other to, in case somebody called out and they can't cook. So here comes, let's pull this person off and get them to cook. Yeah. I'd jump in and do every bit of it.
Yeah. While we were there, I asked to see the manager because I wanted to find out about getting an interview with people. And somebody said, well, the manager's not here, but
the captain.
The captain. Okay, yes, sir. I was trying to think.
Those are our shift leads. They're basically, if the manager's not there, they're the manager on duty.
Okay. Yeah. But just as open and as all get out. Mm-hmm. And it looks like there's there is a road to somewhere with respect to working there.
You know, there's a lot of opportunity flying around in MOD. And great. You don't have to just stand there. You don't have to just be a squad member. If you want to be an AGM, you know, we can show you the proper ways to get to there. There's a lot of opportunity flying around because we are opening more and more stores. We're rapidly growing. And you know, 2015, I believe we were voted the most rapidly growing restaurant chain in America.
Okay.
Yeah, I believe that.
You know, it's the little things so many times. And the first time we went in, I mean, we got our pizza just, you know, we hadn't even sat down and got comfortable before
Eight minutes.
And I was up there, you know, getting my ice, and I stuck my thing in to get ice, and it was that wonderful little...
The Sonic ice.
The little Sonic ice. Oh, and I was going, oh, God, they got good ice, yeah. too. So y'all really did think through a lot of stuff.
Tell us, if you don't mind, something about the sense of community that is there. Charity work?
Absolutely.
You know?
MOD is, like I said, MOD is about the people, first and foremost. If you take care of the people, they'll take care of the business. You get them invested, you know, in their heart and in their mind, and then they just want to move on with it. Every time we open up a new store, we go through about 6 days of training. We have a whole training team that comes in that's designated for nothing but training. And we start out kind of like a soft opening. So our first time will be our friends and family. So we'll run two sections of a three-hour service of friends and family that are invited to get free pizza, you know, just to give, you know, a nice little run for them. Our second day of, I guess, our soft opening is called Bridge Fun Day. MOD designates the sales for these two three-hour sessions, and they go to a bridge fund to help out other MOD squatters who have come into tragedy, you know, lost a parent, don't have money to go to the funeral, or just need help with anything, bills, water, paying your electricity bills, stuff like that. So I think they said last year we, just between the openings, we did over $125,000 to put into the bridge fund, and then our third soft opening day is just, it's not soft open. We open up at noon. And it's our first grand opening day. All the proceeds from that go to our chosen, whoever the local charity is that we chose. I chose for the Woodlands location, the Interfaith of the Woodlands. Okay. And every bit of the sales for that day, at every location we do, that goes back to the community.
Wow. You know, if someone was not listening carefully, you mentioned noon, but your stores generally open mm-hmm. at what?
10:30 in the morning.
10:30 in the morning. They close at 10, don't they?
We close at 10 on the weekdays and 11 on Friday and Saturday.
Okay. That's super. I don't know what, you know, in any interview I do, I don't ask, but I'd like to ask, is there something I haven't brought up that you wish I had?
Not really. I mean, you've covered a lot of points. MOD, I heard you say outside while I was waiting, you didn't know what MOD stood for. It stands for Made on Demand. We don't make it till you order it.
See, that's better.
Perfect.
Yeah.
Perfect.
That's so much better
than
that.
And that's right. Yeah. I kind of liken it. If you've been into a Subway, you start and you tell them, I want this.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you start with the crust and then you tell them what you want from there.
That's how it is. MOD is what you make it, guys.
Right. Yeah.
And it's better than that IKR acronym. I don't like to diss other franchises at all, but we pulled up there one Sunday and MOD was pretty crowded,
mm-hmm.
and I said, I've never been to the sandwich place next door, and I didn't know it's another one of those things, I don't know how you order.
Never been in one.
Pot Belly, I think it's, that was it.
I was going to keep the name out of it, but it doesn't, I went in, and folks, you may have had a better experience, it may have been the look on my face, but I didn't know how to order, and the person's just staring at me, you know, and.
I've been there.
Oh.
I know exactly what you mean.
And at the checkout, the I know they were new, but here's the deal. The big difference, I know they're new and they were starting out, but they didn't train people. They might have opened, you know, not ready to open. And there might have been better service right now. But at the time, I left with the thought that, you know, I don't think they were even glad I came. I'd like you to go to MOD Pizza. And if you walk away with that sense, you were in a
Yeah, we need to let Charles know.
Really push people to make them feel comfortable about the situation. It is a brand new kind of concept. A lot of people just, like I said, they freeze up, you know, like a deer in the headlights. There's just so many options, and you're like, whoa. And the line gets bigger. So our squad members tend to, like, walk you through the process, kind of make you feel better. When we're walking down the line, we tend to pull your pizza along instead of pushing. We don't want you to feel like you're being pushed.
Right, right.
I want to pull it through. I want you to take your time. I want you to have an awesome experience. We got great music going. We've got a lot of energy flying. There's a lot of loud noise. Everybody communicating. It's just, it's an energy, guys. And, you know, it's something you can't duplicate. I've never seen duplicated in any other place I've ever worked or went and ate at.
Really? And that's why, you know, I mentioned the experience. A lot of times you may not like an experience, but in other words, it is a nice atmosphere and a nice, an easy place to order. Mm-hmm. And they must hate when a person like me shows up for the first time. There was a line.
Oh, no, we love it.
And I was thinking there, you know, I was nervous because, oh, they're going to want me to speed up. And I said, you've never been here? Okay, here's what we do. And, you know, would you like lettuce on the start of your pizza? No, I never even heard of such a thing. No, okay, well, and at the end, if you haven't
I've seen every combination imaginable.
Exactly.
So.
If you haven't tried this special cheese, would you like this? Yes, and it was just.
Yeah. Well, it's consistent.
It is.
Yeah.
Consistent. The atmosphere, the treatment that you receive, and the food, it's always consistently good.
That's what we strive for.
This sounds like, I don't like to sound over-promoting, but folks, I know of an auto mechanic I'd like to have on the show at some point, just an honest person. And that's what all we're trying to do now is, you know, when you find something, and if Mod Pizza doesn't make it, I'd sure like it not to be because of us. This, because we didn't say anything, this is something that you need to try out, and it sounds like you might need to apply for a job if you're...
you're looking for work?
How did you get attracted to
Mod Pizza? I've worked in the bar industry forever, and one of the girls that lives in Seattle, I hired her as an assistant manager about 20 years ago at a pub we ran out in Midtown, and then she moved away. We lost contact for a few years, and then Facebook came along, you know, back in 2005 or 6 or whatever.
Yeah.
And then I got a hold back of her, and you know, she was coming out to scout out the Texas market because she was living in Seattle working for Mod, and they had only had, like, I think about 10 or 15 locations at that time, and they were getting ready to break into the Texas market. And she came and saw me. She was like, I'm going to steal you. I was like, okay, we'll talk. So, but I was, you know, I like it. It's fun. It's always new. Every day you go in, it's something different. You know, it never gets redundant.
Yeah.
It's just a fun concept.
Got in at a good time. They were just starting out.
Yeah.
And they're still expanding.
Oh, yeah. I've been with them since 2014, and they are just getting bigger and bigger. Like I said, we're getting ready. I think they had 120 stores on the books for opening this year. And I think we've opened up, since my store opened up 8 weeks ago, we've opened up another 13 stores.
Wow.
Jeez.
Wow.
So.
Wow, wow, wow.
Stuff keeps hitting my brain during this, and I know we don't have a great deal.
Oh, bring it on.
I just wanted to mention, you know, when you go there, they're not spinning the crust or whatever, the dough. It's right there. Is that something they work on during the day, or do we have a supply?
We have the dough trays. We don't spin dough. What we do, since most of our largest piece is going to be an 11-inch, you know, there's really no need to spin it out. Most of that's for show.
Right, right.
We use a dough press. It's called a capone. It's a piece of machinery made out of Italy, and it's got two heated plates on it. So we put the dough ball in there, pull the cage down, the plates, they come together, and then it tempers it. And after that, those dough balls are good for about, I'd say about 30 to 40 minutes. And after that, they'll start drying out. So you know, our dough handling is, at least in my store, I mean, it's science. You know, you got to pull it out at the right time. You got to have it to the right temperature. Press it only once. It's just, I mean, it's the champion of our product.
Right.
And well, that's what we're really focused on.
Well, the fact, and I don't like to call it fast food, but it sure comes out fast, and it is very good. Charles, we are bell bit here. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for having
Charles
me.
Parker, Mod Pizza. This is in the Woodlands. Okay, we've got to get out of here. Dick, thank you so much, ladies and gentlemen. Thanks for hanging with Hayter. Sonny Horn, thanks for sponsoring us, buddy. Later.
Thanks for checking out this recording from Lone Star Community Radio. Lone Star Community Radio is Montgomery County's community radio station and broadcasted live from Conroe, Texas on IRLoneStar.com and Conroe's FM 104.5, 106.1. Interested in sponsoring this show, being a guest, hosting your own show, then please visit us online at IRLoneStar.com and check out the Contact Us page. We want to say thank you to our studio supporters, our traffic sponsor, Conroe Americana Music Festival at ConroeAmericanaMusicFestival.com. For more information about the show, please check out the information below in the description.